This afternoon, I'm so excited to talk to our guest, Frank Morris. Frank Morris, a famous track coach. Frank was my coach, and I've known Frank since 1971, maybe 1972. And Frank got me started on the path that took me to the gold medal and the world record. And Frank is a smart guy and a great guy, and he's a very good friend of mine. And even to this day, how many years ago was that? Over 50 years. That's almost half your life, Frank. Holy
cow. Oh, very close.
Anyway, this is very exciting for me. And so, Frank, I'm so glad you're here. Thanks for being part of this.
My pleasure.
And you know, although we did a Seattle to Portland bike ride once, and you're a famous bike rider, nobody knows that. You rode across country.
I did.
Across the United States when you were 60 years old.
That was my present to myself for my 60th birthday.
And your wife, Joan, drove along in the van. And
she did.
She had the food, and she'd drive ahead and park and read and wait for you to show up and have a couple of hours reading your book. And
it was absolutely a storybook ride, really. Didn't have the panniers.
And there she went. She went right behind you and waved.
She did. Well, we had such a wonderful plan, and all of our neighbors who did a Boston or bust party for us, first of all, said, I wouldn't expect my wife to do something like that for me. And I said, well, every 3 days we'll stop in a motel. So after 11 days, we got to Jackson Hole, Wyoming, and stayed in our first motel. And we woke up in the morning, and my beautiful wife said, I don't want to look at the ceiling. I want to look at the sky. We never went to another motel.
Perfect.
Perfect.
And I know you were doing 50-mile bike rides on a regular basis, several times a week up until recently, weren't you?
Yes, up until just a year and a half ago or so, when I finally crashed and broke a hip pretty bad, and I haven't been able to get back on the bike. But up until then, I was riding a couple hundred miles a week. Something that I really love to do. And to regress just a little bit, because I think it's a marvelous story, regardless of who you are. I would get up at 6 a.m. on my bike ride across the country and start off riding, and Joan would get up and either rollerblade for an hour or run for an hour. And she's 63 now. And then she'd go to the nearest coffee shop and have coffee, and then go down the road, pass me up, and go a few miles ahead and stop and get out a chair and get out a sandwich and drinks and stuff. And that's the way we went across country. It was absolutely unbelievable.
Oh, amazing. She was your rest stop.
She was, yep.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Wow. And that was when you were 60, and a year and a half ago when you had to cut out the riding because of your health, you were over 85 years old.
I was. I quit skiing when I was 83 and had to quit riding my bike when I was 88.
But you're still playing golf and bowling.
I still play golf and still bowl and still do a little hiking. It's as much as my leg will allow me to do. And yeah. So
Frank, so that's incredible. Incredible. I should be so lucky. That just makes the whole premise of my conversation here with you, the whole question of how are you so driven to do this, which is, you know, what we'll get to as we get into the conversation. And I would always start it off with, when you were young, what was it that attracted you to sport, and eventually a sport or an event that became your best event as a competitive athlete?
Well, I think probably the influence of my dad, who was a great athlete in his own right, way back in the day, as they say. And I had a brother 13 months older than I, that we were very close, but we were incredibly competitive. And as a ninth grader, he looked like you did when you were in perfect shape. And I was a foot shorter, and I was slow. As a matter of fact, my sister could outrun me until I was a sophomore in high school.
Oh.
But we were an incredibly competitive family in everything that we did. And because we were pretty poor, but we did have a football and a basketball. And so we spent a lot of time with Dad when we were very young. And then Jack and I were on football team together, and we would, for recreation, we would take the football and go kick up and down the football, and we take a garbage can and put it on the 5-yard line and practice from the 50-yard line trying to put the ball in the, you know, all those kinds of things. That we had a wonderful coach that dreamed up a lot of these things for us, and so that's how we spent our time, and just involved into. I feel very, very lucky that so many people work out because their doctor tells them they need to or something. Joan and I both just love to work out, always have. I love every kind of technical sport. And I'm pretty sure where that came from. But when we were family, we used to pitch horseshoes. So I built my own horseshoe pit in every place I ever lived. Huh. And pitched at least 200 horseshoes every day. And what I used to tell you guys as athletes, you got to do 100 repetitions, shadows, I call them, every day. And repetition was one of the big keys to being as good as you can be, which is the true definition of a champion, isn't it?
I guess so. You bet. So you said you were in a competitive family. You didn't so much compete against Jack, did you? Because he was older, but also physically more developed at an early age. You chased along with him, and well, he led the way.
That's very true. We had an older brother, too. He was 3 years older than Jack. And we would go out and play in the woods or wherever. And both of them were bigger, stronger, faster, and everything. But they never left me behind. And I think that was, I learned something really important from that. And when Jack and I were, give you an example, when we played racquetball together, I'm talking about very, very competitive people now, you always knew who lost because they're the one with holding a broken racket in their hand that they hit against the wall.
Oh, that sounds pretty competitive.
Yeah, it was, but we got to played a lot of handball tournaments together, a lot of racquetball tournaments together. And when I started off as a hurdler, because I wasn't fast enough to be a sprinter, and Jack was a hurdler, so I became a hurdler. Mm-hmm. And he got a muscle injury his senior year, and couldn't high hurdle anymore because the low hurdle. So when he would run the 100, I would be running along down on the field alongside, just yelling, go, go, go. When I ran the hurdle, he was right there, same thing. Huh. And we had a true closeness.
Wow, lucky.
Very, very lucky, yes.
So when did you realize in sport that you could be good, or when did you become good? Or
actually, I was telling you my sister could outrun me. So the ninth grade, I grew exactly 1 inch every month for 9 months. I went I went from 5'3" to 6', and then eventually 6'1". But, and along with that, all of a sudden, my dad's genes kicked in, and I became fast. And so that was how that happened. And then I started winning things, and it just built from there. And then I started getting recruited. So I realized I was good enough to be recruited as a college athlete.
Right.
And ended up going to the University of Washington to begin with. And Bill Bowerman didn't recruit me.
Yeah.
Anybody who knows Bill can understand that.
Right. Right. That wasn't his thing.
Right. Yeah. I had a very successful freshman year at University of Washington and won everything I ran in except the Pac-8 at that time. And I was in a hurdle race in the preliminaries in the Pac-8, and Jack Davis, who was a silver medalist in 56 from USC, I was just about to catch him, and I forgot there was still one more hurdle to go. I hit the last hurdle, so I have a picture of myself running hurdles, and I have a picture of myself sliding through the cinders.
Oh,
my nose above out of the cinders. And that following year, I transferred to Oregon and ended up getting polio, and that was the end of my running career.
Right. Right.
So, and I don't know how much interest this is, but it is really true. I got polio, and I was in bed in the hospital for 3 days. The doctor came in and said, "How do you feel?" I said, "I don't think I can walk on my right leg." And he says, "Well, let's get out of bed and find out." And sure enough, I couldn't walk on my right leg. And it was the end of the world as far as I was concerned.
How old were you then?
21 years old.
Oh, God, Frank, yeah.
Yeah. Not supposed to happen for 21-year-olds.
You know? No.
And,
no.
A year before the vaccine. But somewhere along the line, you asked me, Mac, what prompted my intense interest in coaching.
Mm, yeah. Well, how did you how did you evolve from what you go through the grieving process? You just lost an athletic career that was just barely getting started at a competitive, highly competitive level. And now that's all gone. And how did you get from that point of disbelief and anger and pain and anguish to you're going to be the best coach you can ever be?
Well, I think that's kind of an interesting story. The day after I'd found out I couldn't walk, before that time, I was laying in bed feeling very sorry for myself, and I pulled the covers up over my head. I know I was crying, and the Grim Reaper, just like they show in the comic books, stood at the end of my bed and said, "Are you ready to go?" I threw the covers back and he screamed, "No!" And that was the first thing. The second thing was that afternoon, I went up to the hydrotherapy pool where they start to stress you. Mm. That's the most intense pain I've ever experienced. And I was trying not to just, you know, blurt out, cry or whatever. And I looked over next to me with a 7-year-old boy doing the same thing I was doing. And I looked at him. And I said, if he's going through the same kind of pain I am, I better change my attitude.
Mm.
And it was then that I said to myself, I'm not going to be an athlete, but I'm going to be the best coach I can possibly be.
Mm-hmm.
how that all started, and it changed. This changed my life around, and so then I started doing everything I could to become the best coach I could be in whatever sport I was coaching. And I used to remember the old loop films,
right?
In the old days, you had to have you hold a pencil or your finger or something in order to keep the loop from balling up.
Right, right.
I went to bed every night for 8 years holding that spool in bed, watching films of all of the champions. Oral McMurray had all of his films.
Oh.
Watched them until I'd go to sleep. And my wife would turn off the film. So that's just what I did.
Wow. So your athletic competitive career was relatively short. The next question I usually ask is, did you have any regrets? Obviously, your career ended too soon. That's the big regret. But any other regrets or any other what-if situations? Or was there something that you picked up from your sports career, competitive athletic career, that carried into your coaching career?
I think probably the recognition that a couple of things. You needed all of the different kinds of, I'll call them props, for want of a better word, that you use, like you'd throw weights and throw road cones and et cetera. And I built a hurdle thing when I was still competing that made me be able to get through an opening 14 inches from the top of the hurdle to a shade that I had 14 inches above, and that got me down on that real, what we in those days called the buck, the lean, dive, whatever. And so I started building all kinds of different things to help the athlete whoever was working with, and that can become an obsession too. Pretty soon you're just thinking of all the different kinds of things you can do. And I was very, very fortunate when my first high school job, we won every track meet we were in, and we also won every running event in the old Hayward relays, which some of the old timers would remember. We won every running event. No school had ever done that before. Well, that just solidified to me that I was onto something that I loved, if nothing else.
Right.
And it's kind of interesting. I'm not sure how to put this, because I don't want to denigrate anybody. But when I went back to school to get my master's degree so that I could coach at the college level, I asked Bill Bowerman if I could be a graduate assistant. And he said, yes. And I said, what would you like me to do? He said, follow me around till I tell you what to do. And so did that and picked up a lot of things for Bill, and he was one of the most incredible creative guys in the business as it was. And so finally he didn't care for the discus, and that's another story of which I wouldn't share at this point, but anytime he gave me the discus throwers.
Mm-hmm.
In the Pac-8 meet, my discus throwers all improved almost exactly 17 feet each.
Oof.
All scored at the Pac-8 level.